Well, as you may or may not know, I am in the field of design. I'm in the interaction design division of computer science and engineering. And I thought for a while about what I could be teaching in this session, what I could be talking about. I thought about design thinking, introduction to like interaction design or some topics in there. But I thought maybe I should do something that's relevant for this audience, particularly something I know that you all are interested in, and something that I've learned a lot about recently, and something that I've had the chance to like practice and develop on recently, which was for me teaching online. So I want to talk to you about today designing successful online university courses, and these two things. It's important that they are together. So we're talking about online courses, but also online university courses, not any online course and not any university course. So I will present to you a case study, how I taught recently an online university course and some of the successes I've had with it and how I approached this situation. I think this course was successful because I got really good feedback from the students, some of which I will be sharing with you during this presentation. So this is a comment from one of my students, which came during one of my live sessions in a Zoom chat. They said, "This course is very well structured, very easy to follow. Please spread this to the other teachers." So I'm actually teaching this to you. I'm talking about this upon the demand of my students. They asked me to teach my teaching style to others. In order to do that, I'll be talking to you about four things. It's the philosophy that I built this course on. It's the structure of the course, the tools that I use, and some results and future work and questions and so on. For your information, I have been teaching the course on mobile computing. It's called Mobile Computing Design and Implementation, part of Interaction Design, which is part of Computer Science and Engineering. There are two advantages with this course which made it particularly suitable for online teaching. One of those was that the subject matter of the course, which is mobile computing, is extremely suitable for like online learning, distance learning. There's really no real need for the students and the teachers to be in a classroom altogether to learn this subject matter. Everything can be taught and learned and practiced online, including project work, group work. The second advantage of this course is that it requires frequent revision because mobile computing is a very fast evolving field of technology. So every few years, we have to like almost entirely revise the course content in order to keep up with the times, in order to maintain relevance. We revise the sort of technical programming subject matter. We revise as we talk about like societal issues and human factors and design and visual design and so on. We have to revise all of that. So this was particularly suitable, and we sort of rebuilt the course from ground up to be online this learning period. And so I will start by talking to you a bit about the philosophy upon which I built this course. And the result from this philosophy that I got was my students gave me like really insanely good feedback. One of them said it's one of the best courses they've attended so far. I don't know if they meant only like this semester, this sort of learning period online or all time, but still it was nice to hear. So I'll give you the thinking that gets this result. But first of all, I have a question for you. So please type in the chat for me. I'll give you like 10, 20 seconds. What is the value that students gets from university? What does the university provide which they can't get anywhere else? Like, you can learn anything these days from YouTube. You can take online courses, you can read books, all kinds of information. All of the information almost in the world is available to students for free all the time. Why do they come to the university? What is the purpose? What is the reason that they show up? What is the reason that they attend Chalmers or any university, really? You can just throw out like one word answers. Okay, insights, reflection by discussions to peers, the degree, a system of education. I think that's getting close to what I believe the biggest part of the value is. So there's actually been studies on this, and I've listened to a lot of different people discuss this and talk about this issue. And I will reveal to you what those people think and what I think. Certified knowledge by established peers, exposure to different points of view. Those are really good points. Broader information source, really good points. I would argue that some of those are not unique to the university. You can get them from elsewhere. Some of them, like certified knowledge, for example, in my opinion, might be more unique. But also, what is unique to online? What about online learning within or outside of the university? What do you get online which you cannot get in a classroom? You can do it while wearing slippers, sure, but is that a point of value? Is that something that's really beneficial? Your pace? Yeah, sure. Okay. That's actually not. So I will reveal to you my own list of these unique value propositions of the university and of online, and pace is definitely one of them, although it's not actually included in my list. So that was a good point. So I'll show it to you in the interest of time. I think the biggest, number one, most important selling point of the university, the biggest value that we provide to students at the university is brand. And there's been studies about this, and there's a lot of other scholars and people have opinions about this, and they seem to converge on the notion that the name of the university, that stamp, that mark on your CV, is the number one value point that students acquire. But then they also get an environment where they can meet each other and collaborate each other and build teams and work together and sort of exchange ideas and experiment and so on. They also get, as some of you mentioned, supervision from qualified people such as ourselves. But also some things that are unique to online, which you don't really get to do in the physical classroom, is that, for example, you can bring in so many guests, you can bring in multiple guests, outside sources of information, which would be prohibitive to like organize in a classroom settings. When we gave this course physically, we had like one or two guest lecturers. This year, I was able to include like six or seven, I think, in addition to some other sort of guest content, which was recorded. You can develop written communication skills, which you don't really have the time or the space for in the classroom, the mental space. So written communication, thoughtful, deliberate discussions on your own time, at your own pace, is unique to online. And finally, remote work experience, which is a tremendously valuable skill in this day and age, is something that you can uniquely develop online. So I wanted to capitalize on these points when I developed this course structure and content. I never try to like recover what we lost by not being physical, but I try to capitalize to gain these points, to utilize these strengths, rather than trying to recover, mitigate the weaknesses of having to teach online and not being able to get in a classroom together. So I opted to not give live lectures. I opted to not have verbal discussions between students or between students and myself. I never did live exams, especially like live proctoring, where you sit in front of a webcam doing your thing and you're monitored for like not cheating. That, I think, is a massive, massive, you know, privacy violation. I think that should be illegal, to be honest. And I also did not give them group work in groups of larger than two people. I don't think these are not valuable, by the way. I think there are places where these things are valuable. You can do them. They can be a great part of learning, but I think they already have plenty of these other places where they can practice these things. This course can build on other things and still be valuable to them. So the target, the credit load of this course was equivalent to a 20-hour workload per week. And this I organized in terms of 2 hours of live sessions in Zoom, like we're doing right now, although only 1 hour of this was actually mandatory. The other hour was optional. 5 hours of study and discussion sessions where they sat and like consumed videos and text and other sort of interactive exercises, and they commented on these things. They always left their opinions and learnings and articulated what they got and what they sort of even disagreed with within the content. And they had every week 10 hours of project and programming work until the last 2 weeks of the course, where it's like completely project and programming work. When it's made into a picture, it looks like this. So this is a sort of illustration of the calendar of our course, where the red stuff is the live sessions that they have to attend, and The white stuff is what they study on their own in front of a computer on their own time. And the blue stuff is programming and project work. And the programming exercises are done individually and they're graded. And the project work is done in groups of two and not larger, because when you exceed the two people, when it's three people, four people, then coordination becomes a significant time cost. It becomes an issue. And there's also like a 3-hour sort of safety factor every week in case they want to do more, or in case something exceeds the time that we estimated, which indeed actually became one of the things that was useful, because we did fail in estimating some of the workload items, and the safety factor did end up being used in the end. So now I have a question for you. So I need to produce 30 hours of content, right? All of this white stuff, what they need to study. Let's say I'm recording these lectures and giving it to them, or let's say I'm writing these things that they have to read and they have to consume that and sit down. But the cost of content production from my estimates when I did it earlier in the summer, when I'd ran some sort of tests, iterations, is on the order of 8 hours per 1 hour of content. So if I want to produce a video which will last 1 hour for students to watch, or if I want to write a text which will take 1 hour for the students to read, it takes me 8 hours to do. And in total, that's 240 hours of work to produce the content, approximately. But my time budget for teaching the course is only 200 hours. That's what the university is paying me to do. So what do I do in this case? Give me some words, some pointers. How do I handle this problem? You don't have to make sentences. You can just throw out some ideas, some words. Involve guests, sure. When you involve guests, I've actually recorded multiple guest interviews and edited them and put them online. The editing actually takes, let's say, at least 3 or 4 hours per 1 hour of content. Actually, recording a 1 hour guest lecture is around 3 hours, just the recording. And then you have to edit that, which is another. So it's still the same. Guests doesn't solve the problem. Reduce the video content. Yeah, okay. The next year it can be less than 200 hours. Yes, that's a thing that we will get to in the end. So if I do it next year, it will be less than 200 hours. That's called scalability, I guess, in engineering. But what I did was I did produce some videos myself. I did write things myself, produce some exercises, and I did involve guests. But mostly it was curation. So if you imagine all the bits of little tiny sort of atoms of knowledge that are relevant to this course, to this subject matter, all of them out there, what I did was I curated collections of them. And I took these and gave it to the students. So this was like the white stuff, you know, the study and discussion content, blocks of 5 hours, 5 pieces of content every week curated together. But also during the live sessions, during the red sessions on Zoom where we got together, I actually revealed the connections. I spoke to them about why these pieces of content, why are these relevant? Why are we talking about these and not the others? How do they relate? How do they interact with each other? And then in the end, it was up to them to determine like what are the most important sort of 8 or 9 pieces of content or 10 that are extremely sort of relevant for their purposes, what they really want to execute on. And then they took those and materialized them, executed them in a project. So that was what it looked like. And when I implemented that, I got really good results. My students thought that this course was very anchored in the real world instead of being purely academic, because we involved a lot of curated resources from all over the place. We did involve academic papers, some things derived from books, YouTube videos, interviews with different people that I recorded or found elsewhere. And we got good results in terms of student engagement from this. In the chat, I got a question saying, so you integrated already existing material. Yeah, that's true. I curated a lot of things. I think I produced from scratch maybe 30% of the content, which was within the time budget, and curated the rest. So one insight from marketing, by the way, just a side note, marketing people recently have been saying that people think that consumers want choice. Consumers don't want choice. Your students don't want choice. They want to be confident in the choices, in the options that they already have. So you are much better off, and they are much better off, when you choose and provide to them a small number of things which you have selected very, very well, very rigorously, very appropriately, very tastefully. That's a word that I really love, tastefulness, which is very relevant in design in some ways. So some of the tools that I use to actually make this happen, to get this result, I used Premiere for video editing. I host my videos on YouTube. I actually have an entire channel set up, mostly with the content from this course, but other different pieces of content will be developed and hosted there in the future. Obviously, Canvas. I use a program called Figma for building the visuals, for building some of the visuals that you've seen also in this presentation. I use Keynote to build and export my slides. And this app called Mm-hmm is my special sauce, where it allows me to like overlay these pictures on my video and toggle the transparency and so on. So this combination of tools was really appreciated by the students. What I want to bring to your attention is that I actually never, almost never used any of these before this summer. All of these tools I learned in this like sort of pandemic timeline, although I had experiences with some similar tools before, but this level of expertise that I have right now, 80, 90% of this was developed over the summer while I developed this course. And someone asked me if I'm using Mm-hmm right now. Indeed, that's what I'm using. And Mm-hmm is actually beta software. It's not even released yet. You have to like apply for like to get an invitation to use the software. So I there's a point that I want to make with this, but I'll get to that in a moment. So when you implement those tools, when you become proficient and really execute using a sophisticated set of tools for teaching, this is the kind of comment you get from students. So this was typed to me by one of the students in chat. And they said it's the best Zoom lecture yet, and it's high quality stuff. And obviously the camera and the image and the photography also, like the light and everything, does also figure in that. But I think it's a high sort of overall proficiency as a principle is what pays off. A little bit about Canvas and course structure. I'd like to keep things extremely simple. So this is my entire course in Canvas. This is what it looks like, separated in weeks. So each week contains 5 items of work, and then there's the project deliverables, assignments, and then there's the implementation programming assignments. This is what it looks like inside one of those weeks, where it's just simply every block, every module is just like 5 items. And each of those is worth like 1 points, where they go in and like comment on these things and give their opinions or agreements and disagreements and so on. This is what the project module looks like, where all of the deliverables are in order with points assigned, grading all clear, all the deadlines very clear, all of the workflow super clear in there. And this is what it looks like inside one of those pieces of study content, where it's a bunch of explanations. And then there's, let's say it's a video, or it might be a list of like readings, and then a bunch of questions to which they respond to in the comments in order to get the grade. And we do also offer optional content on top of these mandatory sort of things. There are 2 principles here at play. One of them is you really have to be proficient with your tools. Guys, really, I believe and I execute this principle, no excuses. You know, there's no reason why you should not be 100% proficient and expert in using every single tool that you are using to teach. Zoom, Canvas, Word, you know, LaTeX, Figma, whatever, Keynote, PowerPoint. You should be 100% an expert on all of those tools. That's my opinion. That's what I practice. And I recommend it to all of you, because it really gets great results. Students have so much more confidence. Your credibility in the eyes of students goes so much more up. And I can tell you from having recently been a student, so I finished my PhD last year and began teaching full-time on these courses this year. I can tell you in the eyes of students, if you lack the proficiency, your credibility and the engagement of students will go down very rapidly. And the second principle is be organized. Be simple. Keep things very clear. I also have a little secret tool that I already spoke to you about, this lecture on how to speak by Professor Patrick Winston. I studied and implemented a lot of the principles, a lot of the sort of tactics that he gives in this little video across my teaching and across other sort of content production lecturing videos as well. So when you do all of those things, as I said, student engagement goes way up. You know, I have these every week. There's an optional session that we have. And last week I was very surprised because most people showed up, and it's supposed to be like a AMA, like ask me anything, or office hours session where they come with questions. More than half of the class shows up and they do not even have questions. They just come to like watch me talk freestyle for half an hour. And I try to fill that time with some appropriate content. Not just, you know, talking about life. It's always content that's relevant to the course. But they show up to this optional session on Zoom for 1 hour just to see, to hear that. Like this to me was unbelievable. I was expecting like five people. In recent years, when I held office hours in a physical classroom, maybe two or three people showed up. This was for me, this was mind-boggling. And this was like one of the most important sort of points that revealed to me that some of these principles, some of these tactics actually work. Finally, results. As I said, I think the opinions of students and their level of engagement was really good. It was excellent, really, beyond any like live physical course that I've taught or TA'd for in the past. The quality of the work that they are submitting, you know, the thoughtfulness, the quality of the comments they make, the quality of the project deliverables that they're submitting is really excellent. I'm enjoying grading so much. I can't even, it's like having private, you know, artworks or science fiction made for me that I look at every week and I sort of comment on them. It's so nice. And the quality of my life, because I don't have to deliver Zoom lectures for 5 hours every week, has really improved. So it's a great results in terms of all of these dimensions. And some questions for future that we don't really know yet that I would like to find out is like the actual final work quality. The course is not over yet, so I don't know what they will actually come up with, how well they will implement the learnings of the final sort of artifact, the actual relevance of the teachings to their, you know, later careers and lives and so on. Is in some ways we will never know, right? Maybe in 5 years we'll find out if we come into contact with one of them. The teacher workload was very high because this was the first time we were implementing this course in this fashion. And sort of future scalability, you know, the next iteration of this course, is it going to take the same amount of work or less? We will find that out in the future. So this talk that I just gave you, I told you that I will not talk about design, that I will not be teaching you my sort of area of expertise, what I teach the students. But in a way, actually, this demonstrates some of the most important principles in our field, in design, which is that design is about both strategizing, about thinking, decision-making, hence the philosophy of the course that I explained to you, and it's about tactics. It's about execution. It's about what you do with your hands. I also made a YouTube video about this, which you can go and watch if you like, which is another reason why I did not talk about this subject, because I have these bits and pieces, excerpts from the course, and other sort of design teachings, design lectures and knowledge that I like to deliver in a YouTube channel where I'm collecting all these videos. So you're welcome to check it out if you want to learn more about our subject, about the intersection of product design and computer science, which is our field, interaction design. This is up there for you to check out if that's something you're interested in. Thank you for listening and being here with me.